joy, 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 joy down in my heart, down in my heart to stay.
Christmas Eve morn to all. Our call to worship this morning is from the Gospel of Luke, the second chapter, verses 10 through 14, and that's found on page 919 of the Church Bible. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy, which will be for all the people. For today, in the city of David, there has been born for you a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger. And suddenly, there appeared with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among men with whom he is pleased." Heavenly Father, on this Christmas Eve morn, we begin to celebrate one of the great events in the history of the world, the birth of your Son. We are grateful and humbled that you would give your Son to the world as the light of the world, and we pray that all will come to know him. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Good morning, church. Welcome on this Christmas Sunday morning. Lord bless you for being here. Before we get into announcements, please turn off your cell phones or put them on manner mode if you haven't done so already. Greatly appreciate that. Let me see. And if you're visiting today, we welcome you this morning. Elaine, I see somebody next to you. Hey, Mark. Lord bless you. Colorado, huh? All right. You know, I activated Siri, right? And that thing just pops up on my phone, and it just starts talking. I just got to deactivate it. That's okay. It's all good. Well, Mark, Lord bless you and for being here. And I always say when people visit, we pray that you find the Spirit of Christ here in this church and his people. Okay. Very quickly. We have a Christmas Eve service tonight at 6 o'clock. Lots of Christmas carols. I'll have a message as well. I say devotional thought. Hopefully it's not super long. Anyway, so that is available this evening. If for some reason you're unable to make that, the Lord bless you and keep you, and we pray that you have a wonderful Christmas day around family, friends, loved ones, where Christ is at the center. Amen. Okay, let me see. Also, the flowers this morning are given in loving memory to the glory of God by Robin and Ann McDonald in memory of Harriet Perry. Oh my goodness, how many years, Jeanette, has Harriet been deceased? A few years, yeah. Oh my goodness. Harriet was so faithful to come to church, and just a very, very determined woman, if that's the right word, right? Determined determined on steroids. Okay. If you see Robin and Ann, thank them for that. Okay, thank them for the flowers. Discipleship pushed back to January 21st, Sunday. No Bible study this upcoming Wednesday, but we'll resume a week from this coming Wednesday. Jane, did you seem to have an announcement? Because I saw you note a...
Yes.
Okay.
Your wife wanted me to announce.
Okay.
So, thank you.
Now, she didn't want to make the announcement?
We co-chair.
Oh, okay.
We take the turns. The shoebox.
Yes.
Operation Christmas charity.
Yes.
The region's filling up. We thank you all. However, you know, if you want to order and you haven't yet, you still have the chance.
Hopefully awesome.
By the 31st of this month.
Okay.
All right.
Very good.
Thank you so much, everyone.
Thank you for your giving to that ministry. All right. Yes, go ahead, Jerry, please.
I have a different announcement. you may recall that we passed out forms to members several weeks ago. For service for next year, 2024, and people did do what they were supposed to and fill them out. So we have a sheet in posted in both buildings right now of the proposed officers and ministry teams for 2024. So take a look at that when you get a chance, and that will be leading up to the business meeting in January. Okay? Thank you.
Okay, awesome. Annie, do you have something? No. Liz? Thank you, Liz. I'm sorry, I'm like, you know, you ever see the auction where the guy, he had just kind of, and he's like, I got 100,000, and then somebody, I got 150,000.
Okay. I just want to mention, there are cards on the back table brought in for the people, so if anybody, you know, please check the back table for cards brought in.
Yeah, please take your cards, because every single year I've got cards that I have to, you know, they're back on the back table, and people, you know, it's a shame that you don't get to open them for Christmas, right? So I'll try to remind you at the end of the service to take your Christmas cards, okay? All right, anybody else? Sandy.
For some reason, this is when he always steps back and lets me do the talking. Anyway, we have been here a long time, but we know that we've always been very supported and loved by each and every one of you, and it goes right back to you. We love and care about each one of you, and you are our second family, but we spend a lot of time together, and we care about each and every one of you and what's going on in your lives. So we just thank you from the bottom of our hearts, and we just pray God's blessing on each one of you.
Lovely said. And he loves you and cares way, way more than we ever could.
Yes.
Amen. Praise God from whom all blessings flow. You folks are one of the greatest blessings in our lives. People are the greatest blessings. You know, the stuff fades and breaks, right, and fades away, but you folks are very, very precious, a great, great blessing to my heart, and more so to God's heart. Amen. All right, any other comments, or we're all set? Okay, and our next song then. Bob, will you come please lead us in our next song?
Please turn over to number 270. 270, Joy to the World. Please stand. Makes the nations prove
wonders of his love and one and wonders of his love.
You may be seated.
Our tithes and offering verse this morning is also from the second chapter of the Gospel of Luke. For today, in the city of David, there has been born for you a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. Heavenly Father, bless our gifts to this ministry, the good ground of this ministry. Multiply it. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.
Amen.
This thing is tired. Kind of like me. What's that? So, folks, I want to, before we have a word of prayer, I want to read something to you. Dave Norcross, God bless Dave, he's going through a tough time, but is firm and established in his faith. But Dave used to read this, and I want to read this this morning. There is it's called One Solitary Life That Changed the World by James A. Francis. Here is a man who was born in an obscure village, the child of a peasant woman. He grew up in another obscure village. He worked in a carpenter shop until he was 30, and then for 3 years, he was an itinerant preacher. He never wrote a book. He never held an office. He never owned a home. He never had a family. He never went to college. He never put his foot inside a big city. He never traveled 200 miles from the place where he was born. He never did one of the things that contemporary society would consider a sign of greatness. He had no credentials but himself. He had nothing of this world, only the power of his divine manhood. While still a young man, the tide of popular opinion turned against him. His friends ran away. One of them denied him, another betrayed him. He was turned over to his enemies, and he went through the mockery of a trial. He was nailed to a cross between two thieves, While he was dying, his executioners gambled for the only piece of property he ever had on earth, his coat. When he was dead, he was taken down and laid in a borrowed grave through the pity of a friend. 20 centuries have come and gone, and today he is the centerpiece of the human race, the greatest source of guidance and divine inspiration. I am far within the mark when I say that all the armies that ever marched and all the navies that were ever built and all the parliaments that ever sat and all the kings that ever reigned, put together, all of them put together, have not affected the life of man upon this earth as powerfully as that one solitary life, Jesus. Why would the Lord of the universe, God in the flesh, allow himself to be captured, falsely accused, tried and condemned, whipped, stripped, and nailed to a cross like a common criminal? The answer is simple: because he loved you and me. All of us at times have done wrong and have been unloving and unkind to others. The Bible says that all have sinned and fall short of the glory of God. The worst thing about our sins is that they separate us from God, who is absolutely sinless and perfect. In order to bring us to God, Jesus, the sinless Son of God, took the sins of all mankind upon himself. He took the punishment for our sins and suffered the horrible pain of death by crucifixion. He died the death of a sinner, that through his sacrifice we might find forgiveness and freedom from our sins. If you haven't met or received Jesus or received his forgiveness and the gift of eternal life, you can do that right now by praying, "Thank you, Jesus, for paying the price for my mistakes and wrongs so I can be forgiven. I ask you, dear Jesus, to please come into my heart, forgive me, and give me your gift of eternal life. Amen." Amen. Let's have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, your ways are not the ways of the world, and they're not our ways, and we thank God for that. We bless you for that. And we bless you that you made a way in a manger, and you made a way all the way to the cross that we might have the gift of eternal life. What a wonderful Savior, what a wonderful Lord. What a wonderful gift, giving yourself to the world, to every man and woman. Just an incredible, incredible Savior and an incredible gospel. And Father, I pray this hour, this day, the world over, that you would visit hearts that are unbelieving, and that you would open their eyes and their hearts to the glories of Christ, to the truth of the gospel. As Bill reminded us this morning, the light of the world, and that their darkness would be dispelled by the glories of Christ. We thank you, Lord, for the way in which you move in hearts and how you water hearts, how you plant the word of God, the seed, and how you water it and how you bring forth growth and fruit. And we're living testimonies of that, Lord, and we just bless you. That's why we're here today, to exalt you and to lift you up and celebrate your life and taking flesh upon yourself and being so caring and loving and empathetic. We bless you for that. Father, I lift up Carl, who has COVID this morning. I pray that his wife wouldn't get it. Pray that Noreen wouldn't get it. Pray that you would encourage his heart and strengthen him. I also, Father, think of Janelle and Drew as they're coming and getting off of COVID. Also, Lord, too, I lift up Keith, Thank you for the strength of heart, mind, and soul that you've given Keith to be able to go through all these tremendous trials. And we pray that you would visit him this morning in his time of healing, and just fill his heart with great, great joy and peace in you. Lord, I think of Patricia, who's going to undergo a procedure in a couple days. Give her peace. I think of Fred, Mickey, Edie Jackson, Dave, with their trials that they have going on, and also, Father, last but not least, Jerry. May you visit him in the nursing home where he is in Rochester this morning. Remind him of your great, great love, and remind him that we love him and that he's prayed for. And Father, whatever else might be on our hearts and minds this morning, maybe there's concerns about family not getting along or a lot of friction. Maybe there's broken relationships. Maybe there's the inability to get together for the holidays for some reason. And people get so depressed and so discouraged and so down during the holidays. I pray that you would refocus those hearts that are dealing with depression and struggling with relationships, that you would refocus them, and that as the psalmist, that they would ask the question, why are you in despair, O my soul? Hope in God. So I pray that you would visit them in that way. Thank you for each heart that's here. We want to give you all the praise, the honor, and the glory. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, so at this particular time, Jerry and Bob are going to bless us with special music. Thanks, folks.
True holy night, the His law is love, and His gospel is peace. Chains shall He break, for the slave is a brother, and in His name all oppression shall cease. Sweet hymns of joy,
so much. You too, ma'am.
Our first scripture reading this morning is from the Old Testament, from the 9th chapter of the book of Isaiah, verses 6 and 7, and that begins on page 618 of the Church Bible. For a child will be born to us, a son will be given to us, and the government will rest on his shoulders, and his name will be called Wonderful Counselor, Mighty God, Eternal Father, Prince of Peace. There will be no end to the increase of his government or of peace on the throne of David and over his kingdom, to establish it and uphold it with justice and righteousness from then on and forevermore. The zeal of the Lord of hosts will accomplish this. This is the word of our Lord.
Amen. Thanks, Bill. You know, every time I hear that scripture, I think of the governments of the world, our government, and the mess that we're in. Amen. And God's going to straighten it all out. Okay. Our next song, Hope Was Born This Night. Please stand.
Sky. It's the same that appeared and the wise men revered when hope was born this night. Out upon the snowy fields, there's a silent peace that heals, and it echoes the grace of our Savior's embrace, because hope was born this night. Glory to God in the highest, peace on earth, goodwill toward men. Let all of the world sing the chorus of joy, because hope was born this night. I can hear the
Christmas bells ring as softly church choirs sing. It's the song used to praise the ancient days when hope was born this night. There are angels in this place, and my heart resounds with the praise. Like a shepherd so scared, I'll rejoice and declare that hope was born this night.
Our second scripture reading this morning is from the Gospel of Luke, the second chapter, verses 1 through 20, and that begins on page 919 of the Church Bible. Now, in those days, a decree went out from Caesar Augustus that a census be taken of all the inhabited earth. This was the first census taken while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And everyone was on his way to register for the census, each to his own city. Joseph also went up from Galilee, from the city of Nazareth to Judea, to the city of David, which is called Bethlehem, because he was of the house and family of David, in order to register along with Mary, who was engaged to him and was with child. While they were there, the days were completed for her to give birth. And she gave birth to her firstborn son, and she wrapped him in cloths and laid him in a manger, because there was no room for them in the inn. In the same region, there were some shepherds staying out in the fields and keeping watch over their flock by night. And an angel of the Lord suddenly appeared and stood before them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them, and they were terribly frightened. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid, for behold, I bring you good news of great joy. For today, in the city of David, there has been born for you a Savior, who is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign for you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." And suddenly there appeared with the angel a multitude of the heavenly host, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace among men with whom he is pleased." When the angels had gone away from them into heaven, the shepherds began saying to one another, "Let us go straight to Bethlehem then, and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has made known to us. So they came in a hurry and found their way to Mary and Joseph and the baby as he lay in the manger. When they had seen this, they made known the statement which had been told to them about this child. And all who heard it wondered at the things which were told them by the shepherds. But Mary treasured all these things, pondering them in her heart. The shepherds went back, glorifying and praising God for all that they had heard and seen, just as had been told them. This is the gospel of our Lord.
I don't know how many times, sorry folks, I'm a little neurotic with this. I don't know how many times that passage of Scripture has been read, but it never grows old. Absolutely stupendous, marvelous, miraculous, wonderful, just never, ever, ever grows old. Amen. Let's have a word of prayer. Heavenly Father, as I have prayed before I've walked into this pulpit and this morning, and even this preparing this message, I pray that in my weakness that you would be made strong and that you would visit our hearts right now. And it's in Jesus' name I pray. Amen. So folks, according to Nerd Wallet, does anybody know what Nerd Wallet is? Nerd Wallet is it's an app that you get to your phone, I guess, but it kind of helps you select the, you know, maybe the better mortgage, the better credit card, you know, the better bank, that kind of thing. According to Nerd Wallet survey and analysis, close to 222 million Americans, that's 85% of 261 million Americans, plan to purchase gifts for friends and loved ones this holiday season. They expect to spend $831 on average, or more than $184 billion on holiday gifts this year. Another internet article cited an average of 4 gifts per child or person, right? Now, there's always exceptions to the rule. Some get a whole lot more than that. When we talk about gifts, we can talk about expensive gifts, we can talk about inexpensive gifts, we can talk about big gifts or small gifts or in between, we can talk about cool gifts or long-lasting gifts or gifts that, you know, almost kind of break right out of the box, right? Not so long-lasting. And hate to say it, but the stuff that comes over from overseas these days, it's not very long-lasting, is it? You can talk about memorable gifts, or immemorable gifts, good, better, best gifts. There are so many different adjectives that you can attach to gifts, it's insane, right? I was speaking to somebody the other week, and they were reminiscing and sharing about, you know, the fact that, you know, what's depressing to them around Christmas time is that they don't have loved ones to share gifts with anymore. And I said jokingly, well, you could buy me a gift. You could buy me I could use a new car, a house, lots of money, right? I mean, you folks would like lots of money, a new car perhaps, and perhaps a new house even, right? And I said to them, I'll take whatever you give me. No, only joking. Seriously, let me ask you a question. Do you remember the gifts that you got last Christmas? Esther, you're shaking your head. I see a bunch of stares. Look, I don't want to break your brain this morning. I can't either, right? Nobody can remember their gifts. I was trying to remember, Jerry, last night, I was trying to remember what we had for dinner earlier in the evening. Do you have that problem? It's not a good one, right? It's crazy, right? I tell you, you got to rein in the gift giving. It's just insane. And it's totally, right, displaced the focus of Christmas, I want you to think about this. So many people run around looking for ideas, trying to find the perfect gift, running from store to store, surfing from website to website. What can I get them this year? What do they need? What haven't I gotten them? I mean, the list goes on and on. Stressing out, pulling their hair out, maybe standing in line and pulling somebody else's hair out. It's happened, right? It's happened, okay? Just to find the right gift. It's insane. I received an email from Rockland Trust this past week. This is where I do my banking, right? And the email said, caught my experience, my attention, but it said, gift by experience. And I thought, oh, that's really, really interesting. So I clicked on the website, and you know, and it has all these little, you know, these pictures, and you can click on something, and it take you, basically you leave Rockland Trust website and you go to another website. It was so disappointing because it took me to a website. It wasn't gift by experience. It was taking me to their website so I would buy something. It was just so disappointing. Yeah, I was expecting like a testimonial, like, this place is fantastic. Great prices, great people, great shopping experience. None of that, right? But it was the term gift by experience that I started to think about. That's the expression that caught my attention. And, you know, folks, it took me back to the very first Christmas I ever experienced in Christ. All the prior Christmases before I accepted Christ as my Lord and Savior were empty. They were meaningless. They were joyless. There was just nothing there, right? But it took me back to the first Christmas. Now, I didn't have much at the time to go out and buy gifts and presents because riotous living, God took it all away. Okay, I had nothing. But I accepted Christ and I had everything. And what I had, I gave away. And I sat there that very first Christmas with my siblings, my mom and my dad. And I read Luke chapter 2 and my heart was so full of joy and peace and excitement. And let me tell you something, when you have nothing to give somebody as a gift, it's very humbling and actually humiliating, very humiliating. We were talking about humiliation in Sunday school this morning, right? But I sat there and I read Luke chapter 2 and I prayed. And I'm telling you, I think the peace that I had started to affect everybody in the room. And it was, I always remember that Christmas, and it was so precious, so precious. You know, I use that actually as a platform or a springboard for every single Christmas when Jerry and I had a family, to sit there before we ever open any gifts. We read Luke chapter 2 and we have a time of prayer. So Christ is the gift and the focal point. And I would encourage you to try to do that with your family if you don't. Read the gospel message and have a time of prayer. But I told them, I've got nothing to give you. Nothing, but I'm going to give you everything you could ever need. And I talked to them about Christ and the gift of eternal life. And I told them that he was the greatest gift of all, Emmanuel, God with us. And I talked about how he could change their lives because he did mine. That was humbling, to be able to share the gospel of Christ. I was sitting here this morning listening to Bob and Jerry sing. You sung beautifully, folks. And I'm like, God, I'm not worthy to be able to stand up here and do this. Now think about it, folks. You have the greatest gift you could ever give somebody. You're not worthy of it. And yet God gives you the opportunity to give it to somebody else. I mean, the very, very best that you could ever imagine or hope for. And to be able just to pass it on. I was thinking of the words of the Lord Jesus, it is more blessed to give than to receive. It is an honor and a privilege to give Christ away, isn't it? Oh, it just blesses your heart. And it's amazing because he lets us share in it. I mean, little old me, like, and you, we can share in that. That's amazing. And so I took the gift and I gave it to them. And I would encourage you to take the gift that God has given you, the Lord Jesus Christ, the gift of eternal life. And I know you're sharing a day with somebody tomorrow that absolutely needs that gift. I know you are. Share it with them. And I tell you what, the blessings of sharing Christ are untold that come back to your heart. Amen? Oh, my goodness. So speaking about the gift, I started to look up in the New Testament what the Word of God says regarding the gift, God's gift to us, right? The word gift occurs 31 times, 7 times in relation to monetary gifts, 9 times in relation to dealing with spiritual gifts, 15 times in relation to God's salvation. Two of those are where people receive the gift of the Holy Spirit, right? And so I looked up the various ways that Scripture speaks about the gift of God, the very gift that we would give away, right? It's called the gift 4 times, free gift 3 times, gift of righteousness once, indescribable gift 1 time, the gift of God 4 times, perfect gift 1 time, heavenly gift 1 time, and same gift as when the disciples, when the gospel went to the Gentiles, right? The Jews and the Gentiles received the same gift. And you know what I'm going to tell you is, you know that the Lord Jesus Christ is the one and only gift that fits every heart. Everyone needs a Savior. Everyone needs to be forgiven. Everyone needs to be rescued from this lost and dying world. Everyone needs love and hope and peace and joy and to have a future. He's the gift that keeps on giving. He's the inheritance that will never perish nor spoil or fade. He's the desire of the nations, literally the peoples, whether they know it or not, right? The Apostle Paul reminds us about this gift. The gift is unlike the trespass. The trespass was one sin. It led to judgment and the condemnation of many. The gift given now, despite many sins, it leads to righteousness and the justification of many. All because of God's grace through faith in one man, the man Christ Jesus. So I would encourage you at Christmas time, there's no other greater gift as believers that we could give or gift by experience to some other person. Share the Savior, share the message of the gospel of his love, his peace, his joy, and the hope that he gives you. Because he's the most memorable gift that you could ever give. And I tell you, think about it. When you accept, I'm assuming that you accepted Christ as your Savior, but when you did that, you remember, maybe you don't know the day or the time or the place, but you remember the experience, do you not? It's memorable. There was a man by the name of Keith Phillips. I'm going to share this article with you. It was entitled The Best Gift. It touched my heart. He ministers to the homeless across the U.S. And he wrote, "Can you imagine being given a Christmas gift and not opening it for 20 years? Well, that's exactly what I did. Year after year, I unwrapped all of my other gifts and enjoyed them for a few minutes or for a few months before I lost interest or outgrew or wore each one out. I don't know why I never got around to opening that one gift. When I was small, my other gifts looked all the more fun, I suppose. And as I grew older, I thought I knew what was inside, and I wasn't really interested much. Most years, I didn't even notice it. Then one evening, I bumped into an old friend on the street, and he handed me, of all things, that Christmas gift that I ignored all those years. I opened it mostly to please my friend, who was clearly quite excited about it and seemed convinced that it was just what I needed. To my astonishment, he was right. Suddenly, the other Christmas gifts of 20 years paled by comparison. This gift was unlike anything I'd ever experienced. It was intangible and yet more real than the ground I was standing on. I can only describe it as love. Love in its richest, deepest, truest sense, overwhelming and boundless love, unconditional and unending. And it was mine, definitely mine. For a moment, I felt foolish for having waited so long to open it, and then I realized that it no longer mattered. It was mine. And it gets better. This is the gift for everybody. If you haven't unwrapped yours yet, let this Christmas be the Christmas that you do. It's the one that bears this note: for God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. He closes the article by saying, may you and yours experience the wonderful reality of a love-filled, Christ-filled Christmas. Isn't that beautiful? It's sad that he waited 20 years, of course, right? At the outset, I talked about the survey or the analysis that Nerd Wallet did, and it talked about millions of people, lots of money, lots of gifts, and yet they totally ignored the greatest gift of all, a gift that doesn't cost them anything. It's free, it's heavenly, it's indescribable, it's perfect, and it's from God. And so I would encourage you to share that gift. It's the gift that keeps on giving, amen? You know, just real quickly, did you notice in the text today that the shepherds, after they met, they had that wonderful heavenly experience about the Lord Jesus, they ran and they told everybody. It's actually very, very selfish for us to keep that to ourselves, isn't it? Very selfish. Let's not be selfish. Let's pray. Gracious Heavenly Father, we marvel at your work in Christ and how you sent him to this lost and dying world, and how you even sent him into our hearts when we first believed. What a wonderful gift, a perfect gift, an indescribable gift, a free gift to us, and yet it cost you your Son. And we pray, Heavenly Father, that we would think about these things and our experience in you, and how we have this tremendous opportunity to participate in the gospel as your people, as saints of the living God, to be able to give away the message of eternal life, hope and joy and peace in your Son. And may you prod us, motivate us, encourage us to share the gift of the Holy Spirit, to share the gift of your Son, the wonderful, wonderful Christmas message and the gospel message of Christ Jesus our Lord. And we trust that you'll give us opportunity tomorrow to do so. We give you all the praise and the honor and the glory, and it's in Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Angels we have heard on high. You know, when the scripture tells us that the angels were blown away by the fact that God would save Adam's race. Huh? Blown away by it, because angels don't get saved. Anyway, please stand 278. Angels we have heard on high.
Until we meet again.